We have learned about the central venous pressure, and now we will see what is the peripheral venous pressure. Usually the veins are distended, so they offer very little resistance to flow, so the blood is flowing quite easily. But there are certain conditions in which the venous pressure may be increased, as these are whenever a vein is compressed, and the conditions which lead to this compression may be that the surrounding tissues may be compressing upon the vein, or whenever there is a sharp angulation of a vein, and that is best seen at the level of the first rib when the arm veins enter into the thoracic cavity, and then atmospheric pressure in the neck vein will cause a collapse of the neck veins, because in the neck veins the pressure is usually less than zero, so that will compress these neck veins. Or whenever there is some massive organ in the abdomen, that will be compressing upon the abdominal veins. The second cause of this high peripheral venous pressure is whenever the right ventricle is failing, and this right ventricular failure will cause a very high right atrial pressure because of the backward pressure, and then that will cause back pressure in the veins whenever the pressure in the right atrium is more than 10 millimeter of mercury. Then the third cause is high intra-abdominal pressure. So any condition that will be causing a high intra-abdominal pressure will be causing an increase in the peripheral venous pressure in the leg veins, and the conditions leading to these are the ascites, that is the collection of fluid in the abdominal cavity, or pregnancy, that will be compressing upon the abdominal veins, and obesity, again the compression of the abdominal veins, or whenever there is some tumor in the abdomen, that will also be compressing the abdominal veins. So the leg vein pressure must rise venous pressure. The fourth factor is the gravitation. Because of the weight of the blood column in the vessel, and this is equal of the length of the vein, will cause a 1 millimeter mercury pressure below the surface area. And prolonged standing may increase this pressure to as high as 90 millimeter mercury in the feet veins in just 30 seconds, and in hand veins this pressure may be as high as 35 millimeter of mercury. In skull veins the pressure is usually negative, it is minus 10 millimeter of mercury, so skull cavity is opened because the atmospheric pressure is more than this skull vein pressure, so there are chances of air embolism during the process of surgery on the brain. The fifth factor is the venous pump, that is also called as the muscle pump. This muscle pump is very important for the movement of blood from the periphery towards the heart, because contraction of the leg muscles that will help to push the blood towards the heart, and this movement is aided by the venous valves present in the leg veins. So venous pressure is usually 20 millimeter of mercury instead of 90 millimeter of mercury in leg veins because of the function of this muscle pump. If this muscle pump is not working properly, then because of this high pressure of 90 millimeter of mercury, the fluid will leak, and that will lead to edema formation, which is usually seen in cases when the person is standing for a prolonged period of time. You can see here is the function of this muscle pump. That is, muscle is compressing upon the contraction of the muscle will compress upon these leg veins, and so the blood will be moving in this direction only because of the presence of valve here, and not in the reverse direction. And then when the muscle is relaxing, the blood from below will fill this portion of the leg vein, and when next time when the muscle will contract, that will push the blood upward towards the heart. Now sometimes these valves of the leg, especially of the leg veins, they become non-functional, or there is dilatation of the valves that will lead, that will cause what is known as the varicose veins. Veins may be hereditary, that is sometimes the parents will be having this varicose veins and the children will be having the same disease, or in pregnancy when the abdominal veins are compressed and that will cause the dilatation of the leg veins, or the persons whose job is to stand for long hours of time, so in this case also there is dilatation of the leg veins. Now what happens is that in this condition the veins under the skin, they show three characteristics. Number one is they are elongated, that means their length is increased enormously, and they are tortuous, and then they are dilated. So these are the three features of these varicose veins: elongated, tortuous and dilated. So the person will be feeling pain and edema of the legs, and this is because of the high pressure in the leg veins, and this stasis of blood in the leg veins will cause ischemia, that means less blood flow to death, less blood flow to the tissues of the foot and legs, so that there is less supply of nutrients, and then the person will be having this edema. So since the person is not getting sufficient nutrients, so since the legs are not, leg tissues are not getting sufficient nutrients, so the skin is ulcerated and may become gangrenous. The treatment of this varicose veins is that the person's legs are elevated and he is asked to wear tight stockings, and surgical treatment is that the multiple ligatures are applied on the dilated veins, or sometimes we will have to do the avulsion of the vein. This is how the varicose veins will look like. You can see normal vein, blood in the downward direction is not possible, blood flow in the downward direction is not possible because of the competency of the leg valves or venous valves. And here the venous valves, they are not approximated with each other, so the blood will leak downward to away from the heart, and that will cause the varicose veins. This is the picture that we will see in the varicose vein patient. You can see the dilated, tortuous and elongated leg veins that are visible under the skin. Here again the varicose veins, you can see the leg veins here, and here they are dilated and the leg is also showing edema. Now how the venous pressure is measured? So venous pressure is measured directly, and this is done by passing a catheter or cannula into a vein, and then that cannula is connected to a pressure measuring device. If the catheter is passed further into the right atrium, it will record the right atrial pressure, which is also called as the central venous pressure. Now the reference level for the recording of this venous pressure is the tricuspid valve, because pressure, because here the gravitation has little effect on central venous pressure, otherwise at other areas the gravitation will change the central venous pressure. This measurement of venous pressure is routinely done in heart patients to determine the pumping ability of the heart, because if the heart is pumping weakly, then the venous pressure will start rising. CVP line or central venous pressure line is also inserted for giving fluids and nutrition to persons who cannot take these fluid or nutrition. This is how the venous central venous pressure is monitored. You can see a catheter is passed through the subclavian vein, and then it is advanced onward and it will enter into the right atrium. Now venous pulse. Now, the pressure changes that are transmitted in the form of waves to the major veins are called as the venous pulse. There are three positive veins, which are A wave, C wave, and V wave. And then there are two negative waves, which are called as X wave and Y wave. Now, A wave is because of the atrial systole. A wave is because of the atrial contraction, because whenever the atria is contracting, that will increase the pressure in the atrium, and that will be transmitted backward, and that will increase, that will be shown in the form of a positive A wave. Then the second wave is the C wave, again a positive wave, and that is because of the bulging of the AV valve into the atrium in the isovolumic contraction. You see, whenever the ventricle starts contracting, the first thing it will do is that it will push the atrioventricular valve or right atrioventricular valve slightly towards the right atrium. So this slight movement of the valve towards the right atrium will produce a positive wave in the venous pulse. Then X is a negative wave, that is a downward wave, and that is because of the atrial diastole. So when the atria starts relaxing, then the pressure will decrease, and this is will be shown in the form of X wave, which is a downward wave. Then V wave is because of the right atrial filling during atrial diastole. So towards the end of the diastole, whenever the blood is continuously coming into the right atrium from the peripheral veins, that will cause a gradual increase in the right atrial pressure, and that will be shown in the form of V wave on the venous pulse tracing. Y wave is again a negative wave or downward wave, and that is because of the opening of the AV valve, and then the blood is emptied from the right atrium into the right ventricle, so that will cause a decrease in the right atrial pressure. You can see here A wave, here atrial contraction wave, and then C is the tricuspid valve elevation into the right atrium, and then next is followed by the X descent or X downward wave, which is because of the contracting right ventricle, and then V wave, which is back pressure wave from the blood filling the right atrium, and then is the Y wave, that is because of the tricuspid valve opening in the early stage of the ventricular diastole. Now, the blood reservoirs of the body, there are seven blood reservoirs in the body. One is the most important one is the veins, which contain about 60% of the total blood, and whenever needed, this blood is used for the increasing the venous return, and that will be used by the body in the form of an increased cardiac output. The second is the spleen, which although is a small organ, but it contains about 100 milliliter of blood. Then is liver. Liver sinusoids contain about several hundred milliliter of blood. And then abdominal veins, they contain about 300 ml of blood. And then the skin, venous plexus or venous plexus under the skin, that contain about several hundred ml of blood. Then the heart can contribute about 50 to 100 ml of blood whenever the blood is needed. And then the lungs can contribute about 100 to 200 ml of blood.